Hello everybody and welcome to video number 15 of the free online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. My name is Alf and this is a YouTube channel called Der Plasma and today is Sunday. We are in chapter 3, parameter limits for fusion plasmas, and in the last video, as you might remember, we had a look into the different types of instabilities occurring in a fusion plasma, limiting its performance, and how we actually analyze which of some initial perturbations result in unstable situations and which initial perturbations are simply stabilized. The technique we will use is the energy principle, as explained last time. And in this video, we will start to look at the first type of instabilities, and these are the current-driven instabilities. So in this video, we will have a first look at current-driven instabilities. And just as a reminder, we will not derive all the instability criterions in great detail. This would require a lecture on its own. We rather have a brief look on them and trying to understand the underlying physical principles. So, current-driven instabilities are driven by a gradient in the plasma current, which should be no surprise. So, these instabilities are driven by a gradient in the plasma current, and we will here for now neglect the plasma pressure. And since the plasma current plays an important role, these type of instabilities are mostly important in tokamaks. As usually in stellarators and classical stellarators, we don't have large currents occurring there. The change in potential energy is due to a redistribution of the current profile. So the change in potential energy, delta U, is due to a redistribution of the plasma current profile, and this then leads to a change in the magnetic energy. Sorry. And we will first only look at ideal MHD modes, meaning we will have no breakup of the magnetic surfaces. So there will be no breakup of the magnetic surfaces, which is the same as saying that we will have no magnetic islands occurring. We only allow for deformations of the surfaces. Only deformations. And this type of modes is referred to kink modes. So this is what we usually refer to as kink modes. Okay, let's start with an example of an M equals one mode. M equals one mode. Here you see three drawings. These are poloidal cross sections. On the left hand side, this is an unperturbed situation. So this is an unperturbed situation. You can see various flux surfaces. On the middle, this is an ideal M equals one mode. It's an ideal M equals one mode. And you can see how here is one flux surface which is perturbed. And you can see it's only deformed. Yeah? It's only shifted to the right. Nothing else is going on. And on the right-hand side, we have a resistive M equals one mode. And resistive means that here we have reconnection going on, leading here in this case to a massive island, magnetic island. And by the way, if you're interested in learning some German, Insel is the German word for island. Okay, you should all know or might all know the kink instability from your plasma physics 1 lecture, but to be sure that we're all on the same page here, let's make a brief reminder on the kink instability. Kink instability. And this is easiest illustrated with some drawing. So let's draw a plasma column, something like this. This is our plasma column, some kind of cylinder. And then in this cylinder, we have a current flowing. I think for the current, we used the color green. A current flowing along the Z direction, so into this direction. So the plasma current. Then we have magnetic field lines going around it with according to the right hand rule. I think we use blue for that. So going around like this. So these are magnetic fields. This is a magnetic field line. And then another one. Here's another one, and so on. And the shape of this is given by the equilibrium condition, where we have the plasma pressure gradient being stabilized by J cross B forces. Yeah. This is the equilibrium condition. Now let's assume we have an initial perturbation somewhere. So let's say maybe something like this in our cylinder. Some initial perturbation. Then magnetic field lines at the bottom still look like this, going around, but at the perturbation, they are somewhat tilted, maybe looking like this. So these are all magnetic field lines, here again like this. And now if we have a look at this box, this side, the left-hand side, compare it with the right-hand side, then we can see that the magnetic field strength on the left hand side is higher as the magnetic field lines are closer there. So this here corresponds to a higher magnetic field strength comparing with this side where we have a lower magnetic field strength. And the J cross B forces now push the initial perturbation further outwards, meaning that the next time this step might look like this, a bit exaggerated maybe. Magnetic field lines now be like this, going around here like this, and so on. So the initial perturbation is growing, it is enhanced, and probably here at the bottom, this would maybe go a bit more, not be such a strong kink, maybe something like this. Anyway, so having an initial perturbation is growing. If we have such a geometry, and this is the kink instability, leading to an immediate disruption or breakup of the Z pinch, which we discussed at the very beginning of the lecture. And how to stabilize this? This is stabilized by adding a strong axial field, adding a strong magnetic field along the Z axis corresponding to the toroidal direction in a toroidal experiment, to the toroidal direction to stabilize it against small wavelength perturbations, to stabilize it against small wavelength perturbations corresponding to large mode numbers. And this kink instability, although we learned we can stabilize it with such a strong axial magnetic field, is something which still plays a role in a tokamak, as we will see. This is why we will first look at the external king instability. So we will first look at the external king instability, because this is the one which is in a way more important, stability. The external king instability. And for the external king instability, we start with a perturbation at the plasma boundary. And these perturbations tend to be unstable if they have a long wavelength, so a large wavelength, or a low mode number. So long wavelength deformation at the plasma boundary, so psi at the plasma boundary A is different from zero, having a long wavelength corresponding to a low mode number. And this tends to be unstable compared to short wavelength perturbation, which would require locally more bending of the feed lines, thus more forces. So these are easier to stabilize. This is why the long wavelength deformation or perturbation tends to be unstable. And the strong current, the strong plasma current, can lead to such unstable situations flowing in a plasma, in a tokamak. So the strong currents flowing in a plasma can lead to such unstable situations, because with a strong current we also get a poloidal magnetic field. This gets larger then. And having a larger poloidal magnetic field corresponds to having a small safety factor, small QS, corresponds to a small QS. This is why we call this the safety factor, because the safety factor should be large, and then we have a more stable plasma. So a larger number here for the safety factor for QS generally results in a more stable plasma. And remember, QS, the safety factor, was the number of toroidal transits for a field line required for a full poloidal transit. Okay, this is why this is small if we have a larger poloidal magnetic field component. Now, for the description of the external king instability, we neglect the stabilizing effect of the walls. So we neglect the stabilizing effect of the vessel wall. Or we can say, in other words, that the wall is far away from the plasma, which is usually not too wrong. And then the stability analysis yields that the resonant QS values, the values which are resonant with the perturbation M over N, are located at the plasma boundary. At the plasma boundary. Well, for the instability, remember this is how we described it, a mode which is unstable. If the safety factor is resonant with the perturbation M over N, with the perturbation mode numbers, for instability. And keep in mind that the safety factor in the tokamak increases with the radius. QS increases with radius, so this is not a constant number. And from this we can then derive a condition necessary for stability. So necessary for stability, then in a linear tokamak is basically that the safety factor at the edge QS over A is larger than the mode numbers M over N, and the safety factor at the edge is, or can be calculated or described as 2 pi A squared over mu naught R naught, and then times the toroidal magnetic field B phi divided by the plasma current. So this is the criterion which has to be fulfilled to get a stable situation. That the safety factor at the edge is larger than the ratio of the mode numbers m over n. Now, an unstable kink mode, an unstable external kink mode, a few words about it. An unstable external kink mode, those are likely to occur when there are strong gradients in the plasma pressure profile, the plasma current profile, which is not too surprising because strong gradients trigger instabilities, right? If you have a strong gradient, you can easily imagine that it's more likely for an instability to occur. And these are those strong gradients appear, for example, in the ramp up phase of a discharge, when we ramp up the plasma current. And let's have a look at such an example. Here at the top, you can see time traces. First of all, we have a time trace of the plasma current being ramped up. And since the plasma current is ramped up, we get a stronger poloidal magnetic field. Thus, the safety factor decreases. This is the safety factor at the edge, QA. It decreases over time. And during this decrease, it passes several M over N values during the ramp-up phase. And here on the bottom are depicted various scenarios. Assuming N equals 1, then M equals 9 at the beginning. So here we have 9, a mode number of 9, at the very beginning of the discharge. And then we have M equals 8. So here we have an 8-fold symmetry, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And then afterwards it's m equals 7, then m equals 6. And with a further decrease of the safety factor, it's then m equals 4. And finally m equals 2 here. And one has to pay attention that the discharge does not stay long in this situations, otherwise the whole system will get unstable. And of special importance is the external kink mode with M equals 1. So the external kink with M equals 1, this one is special. 1 is special, and this is unstable, or because this is unstable if, now inserting what we had three slides ago, the equation, if now M is 1, so if 1 over N, if the safety factor at the edge is smaller than 1 over N, the safety factor at the edge is often abbreviated with QA. And remember, this is proportional to the inverse of the plasma current, as I had on the board, on the slides, on the board three slides ago. Thus, here we get an upper limit for the plasma current. So this results in an, or corresponds to an upper limit for the total plasma current. And now, if we have a look at the n equals 1 situation, this results in a special limit, and this limit is called the Kruskal-Shavranov limit. This is the Kruskal-Shavranov limit. This is for n equals 1, thus Qs safety factor, sorry, at the edge has to be larger than 1 for stability. And this corresponds to a limit on the plasma current then. So we can just rearrange the equation and getting a limit for the plasma current IP, which has to be smaller than 2 pi a squared b phi over mu naught r naught, then times an additional factor of 1/2. So this is a limitation for the plasma current. And the factor 1/2, oops, this was basically experimentally found. So it was experimentally found that the plasma is also unstable against the 2-1 mode, so against the m equals 2, n equals 1 mode, which means that the safety factor Qs at the edge has to be larger than 2 for stability. And this has to be larger than 2. Whoops. For stability. Now, what does this mean for a typical experiment? So let's have a look at ASDEC's upgrade, medium-sized tokamak located at the Max Planck Institute in Garching, at the IPP Garching. So ASDEC's upgrade. It results in a maximum current of 1 megaampere, and the actual limit is, however, a bit higher. So it's actually not 1 megaamp, but 1.4 megaamp. This is due to having non-circular cross sections, as we will just discuss in a future lecture. Because everything, the Kruskal-Shavranov limit as it is written above there, assumes to have a circular cross section of a plasma. Now, a question which might arise is, now what happens if we pass that limit, if we don't care about the limit? Then the plasma will very likely disrupt. And what is a disruption? So what is a disruption? Now, in a disruption, the plasma typically hits the top or bottom vessel wall. So the plasma typically hits the top or bottom vessel wall. And then the plasma energy is lost in a very short amount of time, actually over a few milliseconds. The plasma energy is lost in a few milliseconds, resulting in a power loss on the order of gigawatts. And since the plasma energy is lost in a few milliseconds, it also means that the plasma current decays in a very short amount of time. So the plasma current decays a short amount of time, and that is usually on the order of 10 milliseconds. And this means that we induce so-called halo currents surrounding the original plasma current. So we induce so-called halo currents because changing current in time induces a magnetic field, which then again induces a current. These are the halo currents surrounding the last closed flux surface, which is usually abbreviated as LCF, which is short for last closed flux surface. And these halo currents then flow along open field lines, that it is outside of the last closed flux surface, along field lines, open field lines. And that means they will eventually intersect with the vessel and deposit energy and particles on the vessel. And then we also induce, or they also get eddy currents induced in the vacuum vessel. Due to the change of current in the plasma. And the associated forces are really large. They can be on the order of hundreds of tons. So the associated forces can be of the order of hundreds of tons, which is enough to lift up your vacuum vessel by a very short amount, a short distance. So this is something you really want to avoid in a large scale experiment. And then due to the release of magnetic energy, part of that energy gets transferred to a relativistic electron beam. So part of the magnetic energy, so initially part of the plasma current actually, part of the plasma current gets transferred to a relativistic electron beam, meaning we have an electron beam consisting of electrons which have relativistic energies. And this is really a threat to the surrounding vessel if those electrons hit it. This is a threat to the surrounding vacuum vessel and or components attached to it. Now, how to handle this disruption? One way which is usually done nowadays is to do disruption prediction with the neural networks. Doing disruption prediction with neural networks, which of course need some kind of training, and the training then are a lot of disruptions which actually happened at small scale tokamaks where it might not be that harmful for the machine. Then you extrapolate that knowledge to larger scale tokamaks, or you do a lot of maybe trying to make small disruption events using that for a disruption prediction network based on neural networks. And then if this network, for example, would detect during the operation a disruption will occur, then to mitigate the disruption. So for mitigation, what is done is we have a massive, like really massive gas injection of some kind of noble gas trying to terminate the discharge before and radiate all the energy away before the disruption occurs. Okay, so in today's lecture, we started to look at current-driven instabilities, and we only started to look at kink modes. We had a brief reminder on the kink instability, which you know from Plasma Physics 1 lecture. we used that knowledge and talked about the external kink instability, and in particular the Kruskal-Shafranov limit is an important limitation resulting from the external kink instability because it imposes a limitation on the plasma current. And it is important to keep in mind that the safety factor at the edge, QS, has to be larger than 2 for stability. And on this last slide, which is here still, that can still be seen, we talked about disruptions. What are disruptions and how to handle disruptions? And just keep in mind, a disruption is something you want to avoid at all costs at large scale experiments like ITER. You really don't want to have a major disruption, not a single one at ITER going on. Okay, that's it for today's video. Hope to see you again in the next video.